can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Go tell that long tongue.
This week, it is all about King John and the Magna Carta. But before we get there, I need to take us on a journey. 2 weeks long, long ago to week two, when we learned about William the Conqueror defeated King Harold of England in 1066. Remember, what did he start? He started feudalism. Okay, so feudalism, remember when we talked all about feudalism and how there was the hierarchy of society? Okay, so William the Conqueror, he started that. Then after William the Conqueror, last week, who do we learn about? Richard the Lionhearted. So this is King John's older brother, is Richard the Lionhearted, right? He went off and he fought in the Crusades and people liked Richard the Lionhearted. And then King John comes into power. And so he's still leading in a feudal society, right? So the king is the head honcho. He's on top. In this society, it's like the king is number one in the land. What he says goes. I'm trying to set my book down. Okay. We've got King John way up here, whoever's the king. And then everybody else is underneath him, right? Well, King John, our problem with King John is that he abused his power. So he has the power to just say, this is a law now. And he has the power to just decide willy-nilly. Whatever he decides can go. He can say, well, this person is disobeying this law that I just made up. And so he has to go to jail now. So he can throw people in jail. He can just say somebody's going to jail. They can go to jail. He can make up new tax laws where he decides it's a new law. The people don't have any choice. They just have to obey the law or go to jail. Or he even did this. He even ordered that his nephew would be murdered because his nephew was the next family member that would be, who would be the king of England. He had him murdered. So the people have had enough. The noblemen, even the higher people in the feudal system, they're rising up and saying, enough is enough, King John. You're just making up all of these laws and these rules and you're abusing your power. You're not treating the people right. This is not going well. We've had enough. And so the barons and the nobles and the people, they rose up and they said, King John, you are going to have a civil war. A civil war is when people of the same country are going to fight each other. So he said, there's going to be a war against you if you don't sign this document, which is the Magna Carta. And Magna Carta means the Great Charter, because in the Magna Carta, it goes on to say that instead of the king being the highest authority in the land, now the law will be the highest authority in the land. So that even King John, whoever is king, they have to obey the law. They can't just make up whatever rules they want. They have to obey the law. And so this didn't solve all the problems. You know, it didn't end feudalism, but it was a first step towards Europe having constitution and a different form of government. So this was just the kind of the beginning of things to change that would change over time, okay? And it's important to us. I mean, in America, when somebody gets voted in as president, it's not like they can just do whatever they want. They have limited power. They have power. They aren't voted the president. They're still, you know, the leader of the country, but their power is limited by the law. they still have to obey the law, even as president, even as our head honcho in the country. So it's really cool to see how that led even into, you know, something that we have in our country today. And another thing is, so back in the day, like when King John was just ruling full power, no holds bar, he's just going for it, he could throw somebody in jail just because. Well, the Magna Carta changed it so that there would be a trial by jury now. So what that means is, like for example, if somebody gets accused of stealing something, let's say they commit a crime, they're accused of stealing something, they have the right to go to court and to be judged before they're just thrown into jail. So there's a process that somebody goes through before they're convicted of a crime and called a criminal that, you know, goes on their record and they spend time in jail and all that. So, and it gave them a trial by jury. So if somebody is committed a crime, or they're accused of committing a crime, that means somebody says they did this crime, they can go to court and there'll be a judge and a jury. And the jury gets to decide whether or not, is this person truly guilty or are they innocent? Do they deserve to go to jail, or should they not go to jail because they didn't actually commit this crime? But there's a jury of people who hear out both sides of the story, and then they make a ruling and they decide whether or not this person is guilty or not. So that's something that was in the Magna Carta, was that there would be jury by your peers. So it really is a really important document. Now, like I said, even after the Magna Carta was signed by Prince John, guess what that stinker did? He didn't follow the rules that he said he would. And so there were a few more. They were called the Barren Wars. So if you want to learn more about that, you can look it up and read about the Barren Wars and how King John, he signed the Magna Carta, but that wasn't the end of the story. He went back on his word and he did things that he promised he wouldn't do. And so when he did that, the people were like, all right, we told you what we were going to do. Now you're going to have to deal with us. And there were wars in England. And so that was not a great thing that King John did. At the same time, we mention in our sentence about the Hundred Years' War. So what's going on here, and this is just really simple. Okay, so we've got England and France. And remember on our map, we've got England is here, and then there's the little sliver of the English Channel, and then there's France. So they're really close to each other. They're just divided by that water. Well, England had property, land, castles. They had stuff going on in France. And France was saying they didn't want England to have any land there. They didn't want England to have any authority in France. And so they were having these little battles while King John was king. And so that's one reason that he really was taxing people so heavily, is because he was having to pay for these breakouts of conflict that was happening in France, between England and France. And so he needed money to pay for the soldiers, to pay for the horses, to pay for these battles. He needed money. And so he made up some really, you know, not so great laws that just really stripped the people of money and made it hard for them to just have food and livelihood, because he was taxing them to death. Anyway, so that's going on between France and England. So this goes on for a while until finally England's King Edward III claims to be king of France. And so then it's like, okay, full-blown war. We're going to have this war, and it's going to go on for 100 years. But we'll talk about more of that next week. But that kind of unrest between England and France had started during the time of King John, and that was something that he was having to deal with, and he was losing a lot of battles that were going on between him and France. All right, history motions. We're gonna start with a J for English King John signed the Magna Carta, the Great Charter, in 1215, limiting the king's power. So we're limiting, remember he had all of this power and he was abusing it. So the Magna Carta is gonna limit He's going to be limited by the law. So, limits the king's power. Later, England's king, Edward III, claimed to be the king of France. You do an F and you kind of flick it out for France. And began the 100 Years' War. And we're going to go like this for war because we've got one side fighting against the other and they're warring. And in this case, who fought in the 100 Years' War? England and France. And this music's kind of waltzy, so feel free to just do a little waltz. And you know, if you go for war, you can even do a little waltz into a little waltz from war.
Here we go. English King John signed the Magna Carta in 1215, limiting the king's power. Later, England's king, Edward III, claimed to be king of France.
This week for geography, we are learning about European rivers. So let's say them together first. The Seine River, the Rhine River, Elbe River, Po, Danube, and the Volga. So I brought my little fishy friend here to swim through the rivers. So let's let him go for a little swim. So we're gonna start the fish swimming where our rivers start, and then he's gonna swim out where the river empties. So the place that a river empties is called the mouth of the river. So here we have the Seine River. So our fish starts here. It's gonna swim and then empty out right here. Does anyone remember? What's the name of this body of water here where the Seine River empties itself? We have to squeeze through this body of water, and it's between these two countries here. What are they? Ireland, England, France. Okay, so this body of water flows between England and France. It's the English Channel. All right. And then right next door, we have the Rhine. So I remember this is the Seine River. So the Seine River lives with her great aunt Francie in France. And then right next door is Rhine. So the two R words help me to remember that this is the Rhine River. And then we have the big brother Elbe. And he lives over here, and his river is gonna start here along this mountain ridge and go out, and it's gonna empty into this body of water. So let's let our fish swim down the Elbe and out into this sea. What is this sea? Below the giant key. What is it? The North Sea. Okay, very good. So, the Seine River, the Rhine River, and the Elbe River. Now, down below, I like to think of these three as dogs. So, we've got small, medium, and large. So the smallest one is our little puppy dog, P. puppy Poe. And it just goes side to side across here, across this country that looks like a boot, which is Italy. And oh, right here, we've learned this body of water too. It kind of looks like a duck, quack, quack. It's the Mediterranean Sea. And there's another sea that kind of comes out of the top of the Mediterranean. Do you remember what that one is called? The Adriatic Sea. And that's where the Po flows. So the mouth of the Po is the Adriatic Sea right here. And then next to that, we have our next river, our medium-sized river, which is the Danube. And the Danube starts up here in these mountains. See these triangles? These are mountains. So it starts up here in the mountains and it goes all the way out into this sea that looks like a boot. A, B, C, Adriatic, Black, Caspian. So it empties into the Black Sea. Puppy Po, medium dog Danube, and then our big dog that runs all the way across Europe, all the way across Russia, and its mouth is this sea. What is it? The Caspian Sea. And this one to me kind of looks like there's a head here and then like a ghost tail that flows down, like Casper the Ghost. You can think of it like that. If that helps you to remember it, it helps me also to think A, B, C, that each of those C's start with Adriatic, Black, Caspian. So let's go through our rivers one more time. We'll start with the Seine in France. The Seine River, who lives with her great aunt Francie and empties into the English Channel. And right next door lives her best friend Rhine. And here is the Rhine. And then big brother Elba. He lives right here and he's going to empty into the North Sea below the Giant Key. And down below are our river dogs. In Italy, we have our littlest puppy Po emptying into the Adriatic Sea. Then we have medium dog Danube, all the way down into the Black Sea. And our biggest river in Europe, all the way down into the Caspian Sea, the Volga River. Seine, Rhine, Elba, Po, Danube, and the Volga. Stay tuned for some fun river facts. This week, I have a special geography challenge for you. So the first thing you need to do is to get out a map of Europe. Get out a map that's going to show you these six rivers that we've learned this week. Have that out in front of you while we move through these together. Whenever I say the name of a new river and it appears on your screen, you can pause the video and find the river on the map you have in front of you. Your job is to listen and learn some fun facts about each of these European rivers. Then after you've learned about all of them, pick your favorite European river and share what you've learned with someone else. Let's go. So, two important geography vocabulary words, two words that'll be helpful for you, is the word source. So the first one is source. The source of a river is where it begins. And the mouth. The mouth of a river is where it empties. This is where the river ends. So whenever I say the source of this river is, I mean that's where it starts. And when I say the mouth, that's where the river flows out of, where the river ends or empties. First, we have the Seine River. So find that on your map.
The Seine River is the third longest river in France. This river flows in a northwest direction. It curves through Paris to the coast of Normandy and empties into the English Channel. The Seine emerges from the earth in a remote place in France called Source Seine. So that is where the Seine River begins. It just comes right out of the earth in this remote place in France. The Rhine River. Find the Rhine River on your map. The Rhine River flows through six countries. They are Switzerland, the Principality of Liechtenstein, Austria, France, Germany, the Netherlands. The source of the Rhine River is in the beautiful Swiss Alps, and the mouth of the Rhine River is the North Sea. Next, we have the Elbe River. Find it on your map. The Elbe's source is in the Czech Republic. It flows through Austria, Poland, Germany, and empties into the North Sea. It is a major waterway in Central Europe. Now, I want to tell you about a very special day in World War II history. So we're jumping way ahead from where we've been learning about our medieval times. We're jumping way ahead into the year of 1945 during World War II. In World War II, you had the Axis powers and the Allies. America fought on the Allies side. So, on April 25th in 1945, during World War II, the Red Army, that's the Russian army, and the Western Allied forces met at the Elbe River. This is known as Elbe Day, our very own Elbe River we've been reading about. This was a monumental meet on the Elbe River, because here the Allies, which the Americans fought for, they were ordered to stop at the river. The Red Army then went on to seize Berlin. And Berlin is where the enemy was. Berlin is where Hitler was. He was the leader of the German army and the Nazi party. This day on the Elbe River was a happy occasion because it meant the end of the war was finally near. Both the Allies and the Red Army had fought so hard. They had won many battles in order to reach each other on the banks of the Elbe. So, just to help you understand, right here in the middle, we have the Elbe River. You can see it. You can see it here. Okay, it kind of flows this way. Now, up here is where Hitler was. Now, his forces used to occupy all of this land and a whole bunch more. They had taken over and occupied many places. But over here, the American forces had pushed their way into Germany towards Berlin, pushing Hitler back. And from the Eastern Front, the Soviet forces, which was like Russia, we might say Soviet forces, we might say Russia or the Red Army, it's all talking about the same force. They were coming in from the Eastern Front. And so when they met here on the Elbe River, that meant the American forces had gotten so far, and the Soviet forces had gotten so far. And so this happened in April of 1945 and the end of the war in Europe when Berlin was finally captured. That happened in May. So the very, very soon the war was to be over. So here's another map that may help you see where Berlin is here in the middle. And so there are forces coming in from this side and from this side. And on Elba Day, they met at the Elba River. And so both armies knew the end of the war was coming very soon. And so this was a very happy day during World War II. Next, we have the Po River. We're moving on to our river dogs. So find the Po River in Italy. The mouth of the Po River is the Adriatic Sea. The source of the Po is in the Cottian Alps. The Po River flows through Italy. And in August of this very year, this past summer in 2022, there was a horrible drought. There was a very bad drought in Europe. And it dried up so badly, the riverbed. You can see here, the riverbed is dry as a bone. It looks like sand. Well, when it had dried out, you were able to see the bottom of the Po River. And on the bottom of the river, they discovered an unexploded bomb. A bomb that had been sitting there since World War II. So that means that it had been sitting at the bottom of the Po River since the 1930s or 1940s. And they finally discovered it this very year. The Danube River. So find your Danube River on your map. The mouth of the Danube is the Black Sea. The source of the Danube is in the Black Forest in the German town, and this is a very hard word for me to say, Donaueschingen. I'm so sorry, Germany. I have listened to the name of this town pronounced over and over again, and I just cannot wrap my tongue around it. So please forgive me. If you speak German or you are a German person, I'm so sorry. I just cannot say this word. It's difficult for me. I apologize. But that's where it starts. It's in this little German town. And that same drought that I was just telling you about that dried up the Po River where they found that bomb, it also, that same drought, dried up parts of the Danube. Now, not quite as bad as the Po, but it had lowered the water levels so much so that you were able to see these very old sunken World War II German warships. These German warships were a part of the Nazi Black Sea Fleet. So, let's just go back for a second. We talked here that the Danube, the mouth of the Danube is the Black Sea. So that means the Black Sea empties into the Black Sea. So what do you think the Black Sea Fleet was doing floating down the Danube River? Why would the Black Sea Fleet float down the Danube River? The Volga River. Find the Volga River on your map. This is the longest river in Europe. The source of the Volga is in the Valdai Hills north of Moscow, Russia's capital. It flows southward and empties into the Caspian Sea. But there are canals and other rivers that connect the Volga to the Baltic Sea, the White Sea, the Sea of Azov, and the Black Sea. mostly about 60% of the water in the Volga comes from melting snow. The rest of the water comes from underground sources and rainfall. For Latin, we have first conjugation endings, imperfect tense, and we have the picture of the bomb. And when a bomb goes off, everything is imperfect. Think about, sometimes this happens at my house. Sometimes I'll walk around my house and I say, "It looks like a bomb went off in here." What do I mean when I say that? I mean, this place is a mess. Everything is out of place. Nothing is where it's supposed to be. Everything is imperfect. So you can remember the bomb is our imperfect tense. And when a bomb goes off, everything is imperfect. And our very first ending is bomb. Let's listen to the song for Latin this week.
Bombas but, bombas but is bunt. Bombas but, bombas but is bunt. First conjugation, imperfect tense.
So for science, we have parts of the food chain. So we've got producers, consumers, and decomposers. So producers are any seed-bearing plant. So we're going to have a plant that grows up. Consumers, we're going to take a bite out of something. We're going to consume. And then decomposers are like our wiggly worms. So you're just going to kind of wiggle around like the little creepy crawly things that decompose dead things. Mushrooms decompose dead things. So let's start with our producers. Why do you think they're called producers? It's because they can produce their own food. So how does a plant grow? We got, like, if you think about like a baby grows. What does a baby do? It eats, right? It drinks milk. And how do you grow? You eat, right? You eat and you drink water. You consume to grow. You're a consumer. But how does a plant grow? What does it do? So a plant gets its food through the process of photosynthesis. So in photosynthesis, a plant uses energy from the sun, from the air, the atmosphere, gets carbon dioxide and water. And a plant, usually it's in dirt and sometimes in the ground where it gets nutrients from the earth. And so it produces its own food. It doesn't have to, you know, a tree doesn't open up its mouth and just gobble up a rabbit or a deer. It uses the atmosphere, it uses photosynthesis to create its own food. So it produces what it needs to grow. Now, we said consumers, like a baby or like a person or an animal, they have to eat something other than themselves, other than just the light from the sun and water. They need more than that to keep going, to thrive and to grow. So consumers consume other things. So what are three types of consumers? Remember we talked about last week, we have herbivores, carnivores, and omnivores. So those are our consumers. So we're gonna take a bite out of something. So our decomposers, to decompose means to break down. So this is gonna be like mushrooms and bacteria, and a major decomposer is an earthworm. So they are gonna break down something that's dead into tiny, tiny little pieces until it goes back into the earth. So if you see like a dead tree out in the woods, and you can just see it laying like on the forest bed, the forest floor. And on top of that tree, you might see some mushrooms growing. They're breaking down that dead tree. Then if you roll it over underneath, which have a grown-up help you do this, but if you roll it over underneath, there's gonna be probably even more mushrooms. There's going to be more little creepy crawlies that are breaking that tree down. And so if you just probably took your shoe and moved the earth a little bit, you probably find some earthworms under there too. So those are going to be our decomposers. So the decomposers break down dead things, and then so that they go back into the earth. And then what grows out of the earth are producers. So you can see this cycle in the food chain of how they all kind of work together. And so, because another dead thing that sometimes you might find on the forest would be like a dead animal, a dead consumer. And so the decomposers would also break that animal down until it goes back into the earth. And so my kids and I took a little field trip. And so I'm going to show you some things that we found related to this week's science.
Say, did you ever stop to think along the way? But baby, be prepared to be surprised. Better be prepared to be surprised. Baby, be prepared to be surprised. It's all I know. I'm not gonna state obvious observations everybody makes, but baby, be prepared to be surprised. Better be prepared to be surprised. Baby, be prepared to be surprised. It's all I know. The way around you, every mistake we make crumbles. When I wrap my arms around you, everything echoes a new song. I'm not gonna whine, you're screaming, I'm so tired through a mic. But baby, be prepared to be surprised. Better be prepared to be surprised.
Choose one of these movements to do while we chant our math facts and skip count. So pick one of these: frog hops, bear crawls, starfish jumps, cheetah run, elephant stomps, or flamingo balance. And if you're not sure what to do for one of these, my boys demonstrated how to do each movement. So after you watch them demonstrate, I want you to pick one that you like and do that movement while you say the math facts with me and skip count. Let's go.
He rocks in the treetop all the day long, hopping and a bopping and a singing his song. All the little birds on Jay Bird Street love to hear the robin go tweet, tweet, tweet. Rockin' Robin, tweet, tweet, rock, rock, tweet. Rockin' Robin, tweet, tweet, tweet. Blow rockin' Robin, cause we're really gonna rock up tonight. Tweet, tweet, tweet. Every little swallow, every chickadee, every little bird in the tall oak tree, the wise old owl, all the little birds on Jay Bird Street love to hear the robin go tweet, tweet, tweet. Rockin' Robin, tweet, tweet, rock, rock, tweet. Rockin' Robin, tweet, tweet, tweet. Blow rockin' Robin, cause we're really gonna rock up tonight. Tweet, tweet, tweet. Every little swallow, every chickadee, every little bird in the tall oak tree, the wise old owl, the big...
7 times 1 is 7. 7 times 2 is 14. 7 times 3 is 21. 7 times 4 is 28. 7 times 5 is 35. 7 times 6 is 42. 7 times 7 is 49. 7 times 8 is 56. 7 times 9 is 63. 7 times 10 is 70. 7 times 11 is 77. 7 times 12 is 84. 7 times 13 is 91. 7 times 14 is 98. 7 times 15 is 105. 8 times 1 is 8. 8 times 2 is 16. 8 times 3 is 24. 8 times 4 is 32. 8 times 5 is 40. 8 times 6 is 48. 8 times 7 is 56. 8 times 8 is 64. 8 times 9 is 72. 8 times 10 is 80. 8 times 11 is 88. 8 times 12 is 96. 8 times 13 is 104. 8 times 14 is 112. 8 times 15 is 120. Great job. Let's keep moving like an animal while we sing our 8th song.
16, 24, 32, 40, 48, 56, and 64, 72, 80, 88, and 96, 104, 112, 120. 8, 16, 24, 32, 40, 48, 56, and 64, 72, 80, 88, and 96, 104, 112, 120.
For timeline this week, we're going to start with 1000 BC, 1000 BC, and for early Native Americans, do your hand like this and touch your cheek and your ear. Early Native Americans, Israel, so get your karate chop hands, put them on top of each other like this. Israel divides into two kingdoms. Then we have an ASLH for Homer, and another one for Hesiod. Rome is founded. So take one hand and this is like your foundation. We're gonna found Rome by Romulus and Remus. They were twin brothers who founded Rome. And then we have Israel, so a little ASLI. Israel falls to Assyria. And then we're gonna do Assyria again. It's the same sign as we used before. We'll say Assyria falls to Babylon. Remember when we did Babylon? And then we have three philosophers. So we're gonna make ASLPs. So kind of like K's, but you just flip them upside down. and put them up by your head like you're thinking, because philosophers are great thinkers. So we've got Lao Tzu, Confucius, Buddha, and then for Buddha, put your hands like this on top of each other and kind of hold it here, and you can even look down and say Buddha. So let's go through our song together.
1000 BC, 1000 BC, early Native Americans. Israel divides into two kingdoms, Homer and Hesiod. Rome founded by Romulus and Remus. Israel falls to Assyria. Assyria falls to Babylon. Lao Tzu, Confucius, Buddha.
Can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down.